I had to ask you this question. Looks like you own a piece of Fear Factory, or the totality of Fear Factory right now.
The whole taco, yes.
Yes, the whole taco.
Not the enchilada, though.
Welcome back to another episode of Last Words right here on The Pit. We are joined today by the man, the myth, the legend, Dino of Fear Factory. Dino, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me on here. It's a pleasure to be here. And my last name is Casares, Dino Casares.
He could tell you were scared to try and pronounce
that.
Yeah,
I could totally tell.
You're lucky I didn't start, because frankly, looking at your Zoom explanation of it, I'm like, is that really how it's spelled? It looks like C-section right now.
I've been called all kinds of things, like Cesares, Cazares. So it's Casares.
As someone with a complicated last name, I can relate. But I was like, you know, we'll just, you read my mind though. You really did. You just like, you just saw the 5 mile stare just overcome me.
That slight pause.
Yeah, like my friend Jamie Jossa from Hatebreed, he goes, you got to say Casares with a hard C.
Hard.
Yeah, with a hard C.
I had to ask you this question. Looks like you own a piece of Fear Factory, or the totality of Fear Factory right now.
The whole taco, yes.
Yes, the whole taco.
Not the enchilada, though.
I mean, I know there's tons to talk about on, you know, the Fear Factory end, but yeah, I would love to hear about that, because I think ownership over a brand, right, and a band particularly, is really tough, especially a storied career like you guys collectively and individually have had.
It's been a really long process. It's been a battle for many, many years. You know, but the main battle started around 2015, where Burton and I got sued over the trademark name Fear Factory, which took us all the way up to 2020. And after battling that long, I ended up with the full enchilada, as they say. I was able to own the whole trademark through court litigations and all kinds of stuff that just happened, and bankruptcies and people losing assets and bankruptcies. And I just ended up purchasing Burton's 50% of his share because he lost it in court.
Wow. And this is why you need entertainment lawyers, ladies and gentlemen, and trademark
well,
lawyers.
Yeah. Entertainment lawyers, trademark lawyers, business lawyers, bankruptcy attorneys, everything, you name it.
They're the ones who actually have the whole enchilada.
Yeah. And you're left with the chips at the bottom of the bag.
Exactly. But it was an unfortunate thing that happened. But I wanted to basically save the name, because unfortunately, because of Burt's legal outcome, he wasn't able to own it. So it went up for auction. The courts put it up for auction. And it's like eBay bidding on a pair of shoes. You know what I mean? It's like I was able to outbid everybody. And I wanted to get the whole name so that way we can continue forward and get this record out and do live shows and so on and so on.
We just saw another example of this, actually, where it kind of went the other direction for a core member of the band with Children of Bodom. So when Alexi and Daniel went off to form their own band, they had to use Bodom After Midnight. And it's kind of, you always, I mean, there's three core original founding members of that band, but there's something about Alexi and how iconic he was as a guitarist that always makes you associate that name specifically with him. So it was pretty interesting to see that kind of iconic member have to now leave that name behind. They weren't even a band anymore. So it wasn't even like they were continuing on. It wasn't like an Entombed type situation. There's a lot of situations like this.
Yeah, like you said, Entombed, there's currently two versions of the Cro-Mags.
Oh yeah.
Batushka.
Yeah, in our situation, there was no potential of being two Fear Factories.
Was it, did Burton own the copyright and then he lost it? Or did you guys own it together?
I had half, he had half, and he lost his half. And so I was able to go ahead and purchase that half so that way we can continue as Fear Factory.
Well, at least, and I think Katie's alluding that you are the legend. You are the sole member legend at this point.
I'm just like the last man standing, basically.
Well, today we really wanted to get into lead singers, right? And
oh boy.
I gotta go.
No, we're not doing a little Wendy Williams here. We're keeping it chill.
We're just here to roast Travis, another singer who.
Yeah, totally. Travis is a singer of a band. I was a singer of a band, so we got two singers against the world right now. I'm sure there's an innate hatred for us. Do you think the singers make a band?
No, but they can. Singers can make a band, but some singers can't make a band. You know what I mean? It just depends on how driven the other members are to continue without them. I mean, there's been a lot of success stories. One of them in particular, you know, AC/DC with, you know, Brian Johnson. You had
Black Sabbath.
I love the Ronnie James Dio era kind of more than the original Black Sabbath.
Oh my God, thank you. I've been saying that on this podcast since like the day we started and no one has ever agreed with
Dude.
Me. So thank Dude. You. I knew if I said it enough, one day someone else would admit it. Dio era, he's a better singer. He's a better performer, a better stage presence. He was just the whole
Look,
package.
I have to be PC because you never know. I might be touring with Ozzy again. But when they did come back with Dio, they came back hard, bro. The first song, Neon Nights. That's like, rest in peace to Dio, because I know it was his anniversary like a day or two ago. But can a singer make a band or break a band? Yes, I believe in both sides. Yes. It depends on who it is.
Alice in Chains.
Well, some bands have no choice because their singer dies.
Yeah, but like the dude who replaced him is like incredible and like sounds a lot like him. So I think that it worked really good for them.
A lot? Like almost exactly.
Yeah, but I think the other half of the band and the other singer was Jerry Cantrell, so his voice and his harmonies and his riffs were able to carry that band and move forward.
Yeah, it's great that they kind of didn't really miss a beat and still put out records that are, I think, that are good too, you know?
I mean, look at Journey. I mean, they found a guy all the way out in the Philippines who was in a cover band singing Journey cover songs, and that guy sounds amazing. And yeah. I think ultimately people just want to hear the songs that how they were originally interpreted. In other words, the singer that came in to replace Steve Perry sounded exactly like Steve Perry. As a matter of fact, almost like the young Steve Perry, right? Because, you know, nothing against singers, but a lot of times they get older, the voice changes, the voice gets lower. Band members have to tune their guitar tuning down lower. Just so they can, especially when you're those kind of melodic type singers, right? And then, so they didn't really have to do that with this new singer. They kept the same tuning. He was able to hit those beautiful soaring high notes, and they sounded like the original Journey. So people going to go see it, they were like, okay, it works because it sounds exactly like it was on the record. And I think that's ultimately what people want to hear.
Let me just say that as a fellow Filipino, we are raised from birth to sing those notes, okay?
I think it varies by bands. You know, there's some where like the singer is totally make or break the band, you know, and then I think there's a lot of instances where like there's the person who writes the music and then the person who sings the songs, and those two are like the most important, you know. Other people can come and go, and as long as you have those two key elements.
I'm kind of like in that predicament at the moment, you know what I mean? But I found some extremely talented people out there who do sound like Burton and actually could take it to somewhere different as well. First of all, you can't force someone to be there if they don't want to be there, right? So he made his decision, and he has to live with that decision. He's moved on, and so have I. So moving forward for me, I just got to find someone who's going to best represent that 30-year catalog that we have of, you know, all this killer music. And Bert had a very distinctive style, sure, but it doesn't mean like some other clone can't come and do it, like a Journey clone. Right. And I think ultimately people just want to hear us play those songs like they were on the record. You know, over the years, of course, like I was saying earlier, that, you know, singers get older and you have to make adjustments so they can sing the songs and stuff like that. You know, Bert's voice started to deteriorate. So live, it was a struggle to try to do certain songs live. So I think if I find a new guy that could do all that and not struggle, and bring some new life into the band and bring some freshness to what we're doing out there live, I think it'll work fine. I don't fear moving forward at all whatsoever. I think this is a good opportunity for me to take the band to a new level.
Yeah, it's a nice refresh for you. You know, I think you find somebody who can, you know, spice it up a little bit and do what he did and maybe even do more. and that could be exciting for fans.
Yeah. It was a big shock to a lot of fans when he decided to leave the band, right? It was a big shock, but I think that once people get over that shock and they're like, okay, they're going to be a little bit more open-minded to at least hear this new person. Some bands switch members without even saying anything. They just switch members and then boom, they just come out and no one knows and it just works.
You can when it's certain members, but when it's the singer or it's the main songwriter, it's a little tough, right?
Yeah.
You think that's why there's so many bands now wearing hoods and disguising themselves, because it's just so much easier not having to explain like, oh man, you know, this drummer sucks. No one will ever know if we get a new guy. We're just incognito the whole time anyway.
Like, has Slipknot even had a career? Okay. Like, do we really know it was them inside?
Yeah.
Like, exactly. Seriously, you could easily swap out.
Just send anybody out on the road. Yeah. Have you, has your search ended or are you still in the process of finding the singer?
That's the question everybody wants to know.
Are you spilling the beans today on the show? Do we have the exclusive?
No. No spilling the beans. But the main thing is to get past this record and then announce a new singer and then move forward. But I definitely, before I hit the road next year, I definitely want to at least put a song or two out so people can like really, you know, hear this person singing. I was also thinking about maybe doing an announcement as like a live stream, where we announce in a live stream and just announce the time. That way everybody can log in to see who this person is, and then maybe do a handful of songs so people can see how this person sings. You know what I mean?
And to Travis's point, do you think that like finding a new singer, potentially someone newer, younger, right? So I wonder, like with a new, you know, some new blood in the mix, like could it really open the aperture for like a younger audience and just also bringing new people into the fold?
Yeah, I was kind of in a situation once before, because when I was at a Fear Factory in 2002, I started another band called Divine Heresy.
I remember.
And so we, you know, I had to pave a new way, a new path for myself, and, you know, I had to find new undiscovered talent. And I kind of actually liked it. And I was able to move forward and create a whole new fan base that didn't even know Fear Factory. So we were getting a lot of the new school, younger kids getting into Divine Heresy, because everybody's all shredding, you know, Tim Young on drums and just shredding guitars everywhere. And so all these new school kids got into it. I think that it could potentially, I have that potential right now with a new unknown singer, you know, leading the charge. And I think it's possible. Yeah.
Well, that's about it, folks. Dino, thank you so much for joining us. Tell everyone where they could find you, where they could find Fear Factory, and where they could find the new album.
First of all, I want to say thank you for having me on the show. It's been a pleasure. It's great to talk to you guys. If you want to find anything out about Fear Factory, just go to fearfactory.com. There you can buy vinyl, cassettes, CDs, merchandise, see all our tour dates coming up, or any information you want to know about the band. Anything online for me, you can find me everywhere. I'm infectious.
Zena, where can people find you?
You can find me on the internet, of course, at Zena Coda, 2 E's, everywhere on social media.
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram. It's just my name, Travis Riley.
All right. And you can find me at Merciful Kate on Twitter and Instagram. You can find the podcast on any podcast platform, Amazon, Apple Music, Spotify, wherever, to hear the full unedited clip. And you can give us a follow. We are The Pit across all social media.